You can start now.
Hi everyone, my name is Richard Perry and I am the market analyst at Handset Markets. This is my latest monthly webinar for FX Street, and it's going to be on inflation and how inflation affects the financial markets. If anyone sort of can't hear me or can't see the video, I'm going to put some slides up in a minute, and then please feel free to comment, and I'll try and answer your questions as and when they arise. So that's it, and I'll get into sharing my screen now. So hopefully you can all now see my slides. This webinar is on how inflation affects financial markets. So I'm going to talk about how the fact that I sort of looked at monetary policy last time out, and obviously monetary policy expectations and interest rate policy have a massive impact on the market, and the economic data that drives that obviously also needs to be looked at, therefore. So it's very important, and we look at inflation because inflation is probably the biggest single factor that drives monetary policy. And therefore, it has a big impact on sort of local currencies, bond markets, and to a lesser extent, maybe equity markets as well. But central banks will often have a sort of a pre-described target level for inflation, and they generally see that as a level that's optimal for the economy. So, for example, the Fed, the Bank of England, and the Bank of Japan all have a target of around about 2% for inflation. And the ECB sort of looks at, in inverted commas, below but close to 2% as well. So they all have their targets for inflation, and they sort of set their monetary policy to sort of generate towards that. Now, before I get into my into the crux of my webinar, just look at the disclaimer quickly, because I'm going to do a live market analysis later on. So you need to have seen the fact that this disclaimer is in place. And the facts I'm going to talk about today are sort of what inflation is and what different ways it's measured, why it's important, and then get into the sort of different impacts on various asset classes such as bond markets, forex, equities, and also gold. And then after that, hopefully it'll only take about 25 minutes, half an hour, and then I'm going to do sort of 15, 20 minutes on looking at the live markets across sort of forex majors, commodities, and indices as well. And any sort of questions you would like to ask me, please feel free to do so. So let's just look a few technical terms on inflation. Three key terms, obviously inflation, the general topic. Then there's obviously disinflation and also deflation as well. Now, inflation is just the generally increasing prices from one period to the next, sort of tends to be taken as an annual basis. There's several ways to measure inflation, and I will sort of look at them individually in a bit. But as a general rule, the sort of CPI or consumer price index is the sort of most commonly watched indicator there. But I'll go into it, the fact that some central banks, such as the Fed, for example, look at slightly different methodologies, but still inflation is, broadly speaking, quite similar across a lot of these calculations. Now, disinflation is basically whereby prices are slowing, that the actual inflation is still in the economy, but the level of inflation is declining. So the level of prices is still rising from one period to the next, but that increase is falling. So, for example, an economy that's has a trend of inflation that's previously, say, for example, been at 2% and then falls to 1.5% and then subsequently 1% is experiencing a period of falling inflation, or in other words, disinflation. Now, the key topic of the moment, certainly contemporarily, is deflation. And this is a big issue that a lot of countries around the world are having to tackle. And this is where inflation has gone negative. Now, the general level of prices therefore is falling from one year to the next. Now, there's a big debate around the actual impact of deflation on the economy. There's sort of two schools of thought, and classically speaking, certainly deflation, similar to, say, for example, that experienced in Japan, is certainly considered to be bad for the economy because it stifles confidence, sort of stifles consumer spending and investment, and that can put the economy into a bit of a deflationary spiral, and ultimately that pulls sort of growth figures lower as well. So furthermore, I suppose you would also say that the real level of debt would go up in a deflationary environment. So a debt that you've taken on actually starts to increase in real terms in a deflationary environment when prices are falling. So that's obviously a negative factor for anyone who's got debt in a deflationary economy. But the flip side of that, I suppose, is where you've got well, say for example, in several months throughout 2015, UK was actually in deflation, but that was considered to be a positive, and that's basically because the deflation was considered to be a temporary situation, and also it was contained to staple items such as food and energy, which is in effect positive for consumers. So people still have to go out and buy these staple items, but the prices of those are falling. So that's considered to be almost a pseudo tax cut, effectively for consumers. So that's taken to be good. But the only reason that is taken to be good is because the expectations are only near term that deflation is in place. Now, if expectations start to change and they see that deflation is here to stay, then it can be very difficult to change that mindset and that prices are going to fall on a continued basis. And that's when factors such as consumer spending and investment become impacted by the expectations of falling prices. And therefore, that becomes bad for the economy because you start to think, well, why am I going to buy my TV today when in a month's time, in 2 months' time, 3 months' time, it's going to be cheaper, and sort of the white goods market and becomes a bit of an issue there. So consumer spending is impacted by deflation and entrenched deflationary expectations, as is investment as well. Why invest today when it's going to be cheaper to hold off for another time further out in the future? So basically, we've got central banks that need to try and engineer enough inflation to keep everyone's expectations that prices are not going to spiral lower, and they need to generate an economy that is not going to go into a negative tailspin because of that. But equally, high inflation is also bad as well. I mean, the classic example was certainly that Germans can relate to is Weimar Germany in the 1920s, but also sort of Zimbabwe as well, as the little graphic here illustrates. So basically, too much inflation is a bad thing, and too little as well. So too little inflation runs the risk of turning deflation, which increases the real value of debt. But on the flip side of that, too much inflation erodes away the real value of money for savers and bondholders. So they sort of need a happy medium, and that's sort of where you come up with a Goldilocks scenario where it's not too hot, not too cold, but just right. So why is inflation so important for the economy and central banks as well? So central banks need to consider inflation one of the primary gauges of how to implement monetary policy. So if inflation is rising, then the central bank is going to need to consider that they may have to raise interest rates to keep a control on prices. Now, as I said earlier, the Fed sort of moves towards is looking towards generating inflation of around about 2% to keep stable prices. So it's sort of tries to generate monetary policy to do that. Now, obviously, this is a big debate in the market at the moment because you're starting to see inflation coming through the economy, and the Fed isn't raising interest rates, so it's a big debate as to whether the Fed is actually moving away from its dual mandate, because dual mandate of maximum, as you can see here, dual mandate of maximum employment and also price stability taken to be 2% inflation. You're starting to get those two factors coming through. However, the Fed isn't raising interest rates, it started to, but isn't doing it on a consistent basis. Now, big debate as to whether the Fed has sort of lost credibility due to all these factors. So it's a big debate going on in the market at the moment now. So that is one thing that has to happen. Now, rising inflation above target levels needs to sort of be dealt with through tighter monetary policy. That is one way of trying to stabilize by basically making borrowing more expensive, choking off demand in the economy, and reducing price pressures. Okay, so the different inflation indicators. As I said earlier, CPI is the classic, which is Consumer Prices Index. It's sort of generally considered to be the accepted international gauge for inflation. CPI inflation certainly, or the data release certainly, has an impact on domestic currencies and also bonds as well. Also, for this, a lot of the time the markets prefer to look at core versus the headline, because the headline includes sort of volatile indicators such as food and energy prices. So it's often better to look at the core data, which gives a better or truer gauge of inflation, because it's adjusted. Also look out for the year-on-year data as well, because basically that gives you a much better steer in terms of the trends as opposed to the monthly data, which is can be notoriously spiky as well. The Federal Reserve looks at core PCE. The Federal Reserve looks at PCE, which is personal consumption expenditure. But now, the reason it does that is because it sort of looks at household expenditure on goods and services, and it sort of focuses more on changing consumer habits, not just on the fixed basket nature that comes with CPI. And it apparently also accounts for about around 2/3 of final spending in the US. As I said earlier, the Fed sort of focuses on the core personal consumption expenditure data. The ECB looks at the Harmonized Index of Consumer Prices, or HICP. It's sort of a similar-ish methodology to CPI, but harmonizes it across the countries of the Eurozone to sort of help gauge that for the ECB, or the Eurozone area. Now, there are other measures to look out for as well that a lot of traders will look at. Now, earnings growth, or average earnings growth, I should say, is, I think, a very important aspect of the non-farm payrolls report on a monthly basis. It sort of obviously looks at how wages are growing, and it sort of works obviously on the principle that wage growth is going to be a key factor in determining such factors as sort of things as living standards. Average earnings growth is a key component in the economy. So if, say, for example, nominal earnings growth is consistently higher than CPI, then real wages are going to be rising, and that's there, and that therefore sort of is a signal that people's living standards are also going to be on aggregate rising as well. So you want strong earnings growth to sort of generate through the economy, but strong earnings growth is also likely to be an indicator of future inflation as well, because people will subsequently have sort of more money to spend, and it generates through inflation that way. So average earnings growth in the States is measured through the employment situation report, which is where you get the non-farm payrolls data as well. In the UK, it is also released with the employment report on the unemployment data as well. So it tends to come out with the unemployment data as opposed to being a standalone bit of announcement. Employment cost index is also an interesting one to look at. Now, the ECI is a quarterly data point, and sort of taken as a broad measure of labour cost for employers. Now, the reason being that wages and salaries account for around about 70% of total employment cost. So obviously that has a feed through to individuals as well. And as does the earnings growth, you also see that coming through into the inflation equation as well. And finally, looking at PPI, which is producer prices index, or factory gate inflation, measures the change in selling prices received by domestic producers of goods and services. So what we've got here is just a list of all the inflation readings that are going to come out in the coming month across the major economies. Starting off with the US here, we've got PCE. Generally tends to come out at the end of the month. And you've got the next reading on Friday, the 29th of April. Average hourly earnings, we had that last Friday. So obviously now it comes out with the payrolls report or employment situation report. So that's next time out, that's Friday the 6th of May. So you've got a bit of a wait till the next bit of data. The CPI is the 14th of April for the States. And that is, again, important, but not as important as the PCE. Now for the Eurozone, you get the German data out initially. One tends to be one day before the Eurozone CPI or inflation data. And German inflation, because of the difference, because of the big size of the German economy, tends to be seen as a bit of an early signal for Eurozone CPI. So that's why the market will look at German CPI as well. Increasingly, China CPI is also looked at as well. For the UK, we look at just CPI and average weekly earnings, really. And you're obviously looking for, as I said again, average weekly earnings to be above CPI. That would suggest you're getting improvement in real wages. And again, CPI for Japan in the end of the month. So what's the impact across the markets? Well, just pretty much as a general rule, inflation will tend to be, or an increase in inflation will tend to be negative for bond prices, which through the inverse nature means that it's positive for bond yields. An increase in inflation will be positive for the domestic currency. So say, for example, UK inflation going up would be positive for sterling. The impact on equities is a little bit complicated and a touch uncertain. So I'll go through that in a minute. And also hard commodities as well, such as gold. Gold will move on US inflation because of the impact of US inflation on Fed monetary policy. So let's start off with bonds on the bond markets. Bonds tend to be very sensitive to inflation, actually. And it's due to the potential impact that it could have on monetary policy and the expectation of future monetary policy. Now, if bond markets expect inflation to rise and subsequently expectations of inflation of interest rates will to rise as well, that therefore the bond prices will come under selling pressure and therefore the yields will go up. And that's basically due to the fixed income nature of bonds. Because inflation is countered by increasing interest rates. However, because bonds pay a fixed level of interest rate, therefore the opportunity cost of holding bonds will increase as in an increasing interest rate environment. So therefore, investors will sort of switch their preferences to assets that are paying a higher level of interest, really, and away from bonds. So bonds subsequently, in an increasing interest rate environment, bonds will come under selling pressure, and why are interest rates going up? Generally because of inflation is going up as well. And you can see here, this is the US two-year treasury yield. This was actually on the recent inflation data for the CPI, whereby headline and core CPI came in higher than expected. And that pushed up the yield on the two-year. So increasing interest rates pushes up, means bonds are sold off, therefore pushes the yield up. Now, second part of this chart I've actually got in here because you actually had inflation and FOMC on the same day. The reason you got a massive decline on the two-year treasury yield because the FOMC was actually very dovish in its outlook, and subsequently bonds were bought on the back of that. So the initial move higher is on the inflation data, and then you got that Fed announcement there. Now, in terms of forex markets, again, forex markets will have moved, or FX will move directly on changes to inflation expectations. And again, it's due to the close links between inflation and monetary policy. So sort of you've got your rising inflation, which improves the likelihood of an increase in interest rates. And again, it's due to the increased expectations. It doesn't necessarily immediately drive up interest rates or monetary policy tightening. It sort of increases the expectations that the market has of an increase in interest rates. And in turn, that will increase the demand for the domestic currency. So increasing interest rates drives through the domestic currency demand because of the, again, the change in the expectations of interest rate differentials over other countries. And therefore, it drives in hot money flows into the currency. So therefore, sort of the price of the domestic currency will improve relative to the sort of other countries or the other side of the forex equation. And the chart here you've got is of October last year, where on sterling dollar you had UK CPI announced. It was slightly lower than expected, and therefore sterling was sold off on the back of that. So, but it had been sort of falling in front of it, so maybe the naysayers would say it was already falling, but it certainly exacerbated the fall as the trading went on. Now, equity markets is a difficult one because the poor performance of equities in an increasing inflation environment is sort of uncertain to a degree, because there's sort of a whole different raft of factors to weigh up when it comes to sort of looking at the impact on equities. I mean, because it depends on the size of the change and also the level of the inflation where it's moving from. Now, as a general rule, you'd say that rising inflation means rising interest rates, and corporates would certainly prefer to have a lower interest rate environment because it's cheaper to borrow. And it'll have an impact on corporate debt as well. But as ever, I think you'd argue that nothing in the financial markets is necessarily black and white, and certainly rising inflation can also have a gauge of improved economic conditions. So rising inflation at the moment, say for example, certainly in the Eurozone, would be considered to be a positive because it suggests that the economies are starting to generate inflation again. So it depends on what the base level you're moving from. If you're moving from a base level of zero inflation and you start to see inflation rising, that would suggest that the economy is improving because it's sort of generating inflation again. However, if you're seeing inflation rising from, say, 5% higher, then that's not great because it's moving away from that inflation the inflation target, and it sort of suggests that the inflation is becoming again uncontrollable, because obviously, as I said earlier, the central banks are looking to control level of inflation back down at, say, 2%. So inflation rising from 5% would be considered to be a negative for equity markets, I would say, but whereas inflation rising from 0% probably would be taken to be a bit of a positive. Now, you can see here that equity markets don't really move necessarily on inflation data here. I mean, you got back in September, you had an announcement of lower than expected CPI. Now, DAX sort of slightly moved higher, but again, not by much. But I'm not really convinced that inflation, when it's only a marginal call, does too much for markets, and you could argue, I mean, certainly in this case, that Eurozone inflation falling to to negative 0.1% would sort of drive up expectations of quantitative easing, for example, and this was certainly the case back in September, and therefore that's sort of, that is supportive of equity markets. But again, it's sort of a difficult one to ascertain. And finally, gold. Now, again, this is sort of based around the concept that global inflation, more specifically than that, US inflation. Now, because obviously, gold, well, gold price in dollars I'm talking about here. So rising inflation has tends to be seen as a positive for gold generally. So because basically gold is seen as a store of value in a world filled with fiat currencies, or in other words, sort of paper currencies that are not backed by physical hard assets such as gold, which is basically all currencies now. Hence why you sort of saw gold soaring as quantitative easing became the monetary policy of choice, basically because quantitative easing was expected to be sort of a generator of inflation. So in a high inflation world, gold is seen to be as a store of values, therefore demand for gold would go up. However, the gold gold price has fallen away in the recent years because of because it became clear that inflation wasn't filtering through the system despite all the huge quantitative easing, and basically gold moves on as an inflation hedge, and you weren't getting the expectations of inflation going up, therefore gold was sort of underperforming. You tended to see gold sort of performing badly in that environment. Now, what you've got is sort of like a period of positive real interest rates where sort of interest rates is higher than inflation should theoretically mean that the opportunity cost of holding gold would increase. Therefore, the demand will fall. What we have at the moment is inflation, which is sort of higher than interest rates that are higher than inflation. Therefore, sort of the opportunity cost of holding gold increases, therefore the price will go down. So a period of negative real interest rates where inflation is above the interest rate should theoretically therefore be positive for gold, as because gold doesn't have a yield and is therefore seen as a store of value. So with interest rates negative on the real basis where inflation is higher than the level of interest rate, therefore the gold price will be taken as a positive. And this could certainly especially be the case as sort of the Fed looks to raise interest rates in a low inflation environment. So it would sort of increase, it would, if the Fed increases interest rates before inflation starts to go off, which doesn't seem to be happening actually, you're actually starting to see the opposite of that. That would potentially be a positive for gold, because that if the Fed does increase if the Fed sort of doesn't increase interest rates and inflation goes up, then you're getting a negative real interest rate environment, which is a positive for gold. So you could see gold being supported, and that is generally what we have actually been seeing in recent weeks, which is where the gold price has gone up from its lows. And I think that is going to underpin the gold price, because the Fed seems to be fairly slow in hiking interest rates at the moment. Therefore, I think it is, and sort of if all the indications from Janet Yellen are to be believed, the Fed wants to see interest in inflation sort of pushing strongly towards that 2% level, and possibly even through it before it sort of starts to really get aggressive on monetary policy. So you'll have a negative real interest rate environment, whereby that would be positive for gold. So, okay, cool. Right, so let's have a look at some markets now. Where are they? Right. Sorry, just getting my charts right. Okay, fine. Right, so looking at what's going on with the euro at the moment. Now, my general belief is that the euro is sort of positive whilst it's trading above the sort of 111 figure area. Now, I've zoomed out here because you've got this big trading range in the euro. It's about 100 ticks between sort of 104.50 to 114 sort of 60 area. 114.50 to on the upside, and that seems to be the limit. And basically, we've just had a rally pretty much towards that. 114.37 was the rally high. And not only that, you've seen the momentum indicators towards the top again. Now, if you're taking this as a long-term range, which I am, and I'm not expecting it to sort of be breaking sharply higher, what you would do in that environment would be you'd trade towards the top of the range. And when you start to see momentum indicators reaching extreme levels, i.e. the RSI up at 70, stochastics overbought, you'd think, okay, well, maybe it's a chance to take profits again. And that, I think, is what we're seeing at the moment. I think that's what we've got at the moment. I think we've got this run higher that's just run out a little bit of upside potential. You're seeing these sort of progressively weakening candles, smaller and smaller positive bodies, turning into a doji, turning into a negative body, and again, we're down today. Yesterday's low was below Monday's low. First time that's been seen in a good week and a half. And again, we're seeing the move down today. You're seeing the stochastics crossing over negatively. And MACD line starting to sort of just lose a bit of steam as well. I think that generally what we're going to see is a bit of a near-term correction. I don't think this is going to start to be a period of dollar strength. I think this is going to be a period of correction whereby we see sort of the euro unwinding back towards maybe sort of 112.20 area, which is sort of this breakout. You've got a near-term technical top pattern that would come into play as well. Let me just look at on an hourly basis. Got this sort of near-term top pattern, 1332. So if you break that, you'd arguably get a sort of a minor sort of top pattern in place. And that is, again, a breakout level of support. So it's a pretty decent support around that level. You could sort of measure that. It's 1437 down to 1332, say like 100 ticks. And 100 ticks from 1330 is obviously 1230. So you're sort of back into the realms of sort of area of a breakout, which was the latest of the previous breakout high. And again, a resistance around that. Sorry, support, old resistance turning new support. So I think that what we're going to see is if you do see euro below 1332 and sort of decisively below it, I think that we could see a continued correction back towards 1230. I don't think we're going to see a sharp dollar strengthening, which would pull euro dollar lower. I'm generally positive on the euro trading above 111 figure. And I think that's what we have in place at the moment. Okay, let's look at sterling. Sterling is, again, if you sort of zoom out, you've got sterling, which is finding resistance underneath this old downtrend channel. And it's sort of, you've got a few factors at play here. You've got the Brexit vote, which is going to be an ongoing ongoing negative for sterling in the coming months. And you've got, generally speaking, obviously the dollar side of it, which is a mixed play at the moment. The Fed is trying its hardest to be dovish, and obviously we've got the Fed meeting minutes tonight and also a couple of Fed speakers today. So you could have a fair bit of volatility this afternoon. But I think, generally speaking, this cable chart is going to put pressure on this 140.50 support throughout March. And you could argue that's a head and shoulders top if that gets broken. Now, the momentum indicators are interesting because you're not really seeing a sharp, any sort of signal, massive signal on the RSI. It's beginning to turn lower. It's beginning to sort of turn lower on the MACD lines. The stochastics are already falling, but RSI is still above 40, so it's not horrendously negative momentum. But I think if you start to see the RSI below 40, I think the chances are we're going to see a real old test of that 40-50 level. And if that is broken, then you're going to be back at that 38-33 level, which was that multi-year low dating actually back to 2009. That is a big level. So let's just quickly look at 10 years worth of cable, and you can see that here. That
are we
those 2009 lows, 36.50, 35. So those are the two key levels from 2009, and I still think that is possible if we do start to see that 38.33 support tested. And it looks increasingly as though we're going to get that. Certainly, again, we're negative on the day. We're sort of 75 ticks down now. Sequence of negative candles. Pressure on 40.50 is growing. Now, we saw on dollar yen a big breakdown yesterday, and it's not really bounced back. The dollar is strengthening against euro, strengthening against sterling, but again, the yen remains the continues to perform strongly. You only got 5 ticks of upside on dollar yen today, so you've had that confirmation breakdown, and I'm taking this as a range play. Let's get rid of that. Don't need that. I'm taking this as a range play. 110.98 as a range up to 14.85. Just take that as sort of 385 ticks. Measured lower from 111. What does that give you? Gives you 107.15. Now, 107.15 is an interesting level because I would take that. This is a massive head and shoulders top, I think, over the past sort of couple of years. And if you measure the depth of that and project it lower from the neckline as a breakdown, you get 107.05, I think it is. So these are levels I think that we're getting now. And look at there's very little real support coming in until sort of 105, really, which was that October 2014 low. So the prospect of further downside is big on dollar yen on the technical basis. I don't necessarily think it's going to go down a straight line, although you do quite often see dollar yen trending quite consistently in a strong way once it does start to move. So that's an interest, but that was on the way up, and that was through the whole quantitative easing drive. So whether you're going to get a big sort of consistent decline on dollar yen is remains to be seen. But I think I'd be more inclined to wait for a bit of a technical rally on dollar yen, because you do tend to see these strong moves and then get the retracement. You get the strong move and the retracement. I think you're likely to see another retracement higher, and in that instance, I would sort of look out for sell signals probably around that sort of 111, 112 mark. 112 being an old support as well. So that's the way I would look at dollar yen at the moment. Oh no, let's look at the Aussie. Gosh, now this is interesting because we're starting to get some bear divergences on the Aussie. So the move to the new high ground, multi-month highs. That move to multi-month highs is sort of not coinciding with the moves on the momentum indicators. We're seeing the MACD lines crossing and falling. We're seeing the stochastics bear diverging, and also the RSI. And the RSI has a failure swing as well. So the pressure on the Aussie may start to grow to the downside. And I think that support now at 74.75, which is that reaction low from sort of late March, I think that becomes increasingly important now. And I think that that could come under pressure. If there's certainly the you're sort of now trading underneath the 21-day moving average, which had been supportive in recent couple of months, sort of seeing that start to turn lower. And it certainly could be that way. You could start to see that coming under pressure, that support. So let's have a look at the hourly on Aussie and see if we're getting any more signals there. Sort of not really too much going on there, but there is a pivot line, if you notice here. Interestingly, around that 75-70 mark, which again is fine with pound resistance. So your sort of basis of support mid-March became resistance, break higher, supportive, and then it's become resistance again. So it is a bit of a pivot line. So it could put pressure once again. And not only that, you've got the MACD lines, which have unwound to sort of neutral. The RSI sort of failing at 55, sort of again, as it did sort of a couple of days ago. Stochastics having sold, given a sell signal and turned lower. So the pressure could be growing. And obviously yesterday's low, 75.10 is the initial support. But again, as I said, it could see a test of these sort of supports. 74.75 is the initial sort of mid, late March. But it certainly looks as though that there is possibility of starting to sort of find a bit of struggling in this upside momentum, even though it has been so strong in the last month. And that has come with, interestingly enough, with this sort of oil price that has started to reverse. You've got the commodity prices that are starting to reverse as well. Aussie is a classic risk currency and it started to sort of show a few signs of fatigue, shall we say, there. Kiwi dollar's been in this uptrend channel for 2.5 months. It's been trending higher. And you've got pretty sound momentum, actually. RSI, pretty solid, that, isn't it? Finding support at 45, moving towards 60, sort of mid-60s. That's a fairly sound positive momentum. Stochastics also sort of forming support around that 40 level, pushing towards 80 again. Support, pretty decent momentum, and MACD lines above neutral. That's sort of pretty much all sort of points towards the continuation of this range. Now we've had sort of 5 trading days in a row now down, so that's fairly indicative of the sort of corrections that we see on this on the Kiwi. You see these sort of retracement moves going on. You see this sharp move higher and then retracement for a few days, sharp move higher and then retracement for a few days. Now are we going to get a retracement again? So you've, there was an old resistance around that sort of 67.50 area. And interestingly enough, that was basically where we saw the support yesterday coming in. Now, break below that would be a bit of a disappointment, but clearly the key support is 66.67 and also obviously the trend channel support low. So there is the prospect of further slide as these momentum indicators unwind. The stochastics have still got further to go back towards 40 and the RSI around 50. As I said previously, gets to around about 44, 45. So there is possibility of further correction, but I think that we're starting to see well, you've got this correction that's ongoing, and whether it starts to find the support around 67.50 will be interesting. But certainly at the moment, the near-term correction continues. But whether the medium-term sort of trend channel that we've got going on here will sort of kick in again is the interesting aspect there. So let's look at the Kiwi from an hourly basis. Yeah, you're looking pretty corrective, aren't you? Sort of, again, the momentum indicators having previously been positive, gone RSI went below 30 and then sort of failing again in the sort of mid-50s. MACD lines back towards neutral, rolling over. Stochastics falling as well. So that all, again, just tells me that we're still in a corrective phase. We're not yet ready to see the bulls starting to sort of find support again and building a new low. So we could easily see a retest of that low yesterday, a 67.57, and possibility of further slide, to be honest. There is a minor-ish pivot line around that 67.50. As I said previously, that was that breakout level, wasn't it? From these old highs from sort of February. Breakout level. I mean, although it doesn't sort of conform so well on a daily basis, you certainly the intraday chart in recent moves shows that we've got the possibility that we could see that pivot line coming in again. That pivot line at 67.50. So watch out for that, I think, on a near-term basis. So if you're below that, I think you're then sort of looking out for sort of the next level of support, 66.67. CAD is an interesting one because, let's look at it on a, because we're starting to see this trend shallowing out. Now, I tried to draw in a downtrend that because downtrend did get broken, but you're seeing sort of the shallowing out of this move. So the downtrend has been broken and it's sort of shallowing out. So are we going to see sort of a base pattern process? Now, you look at the RSI and you say, well, around the sort of 48.50 mark is where the rallies tend to fall over. So moving above that, that would be a positive. You've already had a crossover on the RSI. You've already had an improvement in the stochastics, where previously that throughout the early part of March, they were sort of consistently moving to below 20. They now find support above 20 and pushing higher. So the turnaround in this chart is interesting because, again, this has links to the oil price. And I think that this is something that we need to just consider now. So a correcting oil price is positive for dollar CAD, and that certainly is the case. Now, you'd be looking out for the 32.95 resistance, and a break above that would complete a little base pattern. So that's your key resistance on the upside. And also you've got 34.50 area, which not only was sort of resistance, sort of between 34 and 34.50 is a band of resistance, because that is also that old breakout as well, 34.50. So overhead resistance there, but certainly the near-term resistance is 32.95. But there is the beginnings of a turnaround here on these momentum indicators. And let's look at gold quickly. Gold, I'm sort of debating at the moment as to what's going on with gold, because gold has been in this corrective move, this downtrend channel, which continues to sort of see these big strong bull candles subsequently followed by corrective moves. You see the strong candle correction, strong candle yesterday, corrective move today. So the downtrend channel is intact, but you're starting to see, are you starting to see these momentum indicators just bottom out, because the MACD lines certainly not falling as strongly as they were. The stochastics, again, having previously been below 20 on the turn up, is now above 20. RSI is sort of threatening to break that downtrend. So it could be that this downtrend channel is starting to lose its potency. So I would watch out for that. I don't think necessarily we're going to be falling below 1190, 1190 being the key reaction low, and also the old October high. Now, I said earlier that the Fed's monetary policy tends to be driving a sort of like a negative real interest rate. And that is positive for gold, or supportive for gold in any way. So I think that this is an interesting move, that above 1190, I think gold is fairly well supported, and I think it could start to sort of bottom out. I think it's going to turn into a bit of a choppy trading range phase. And finally, let's look at oil. Literally 1 minute. Corrected, big sharp correction actually. Strongly higher today, sort of 3% higher today. I think it's just going to buzz around on this Doha meeting, and it seems to be the case that Friday was sharply down on Friday, and that came as the Saudis sort of poured cold water over the prospect of a production freeze. But today, yesterday, we saw the Q80s coming in and said that still probably on. So we've seen the oil price rally. So I think it's going to be going on this rhetoric in front of the meeting. Obviously, the meeting on the 17th of April is a key aspect for for oil, and it's going to be a big volatile time. But I think that what we have had is this correction in oil recently. And I think that's interesting because it's sort of, it has broken a technical level, 35.96. Although we're back above that now, I think that's an interesting break. And the fact that the momentum sort of was lost in the rally, MACD lines crossing over. I mean, you've had this sort of your possibility of the stochastic starting to turn up again, but I think that rolling over of all these momentum indicators just reflects that I think we're not going to see further gains above that 41.90. I might be wrong, but I don't necessarily think it's going to be seen. I think it's going to trade around this sort of 35 to 42 mark in the coming days and weeks. The outcome from that Doha meeting is obviously going to be massively impacting on the market, though. Certainly, if there's no production freeze, this rally basically was a short squeeze rally, from what I can gather. No fundamental improvement, just a short squeeze rally on that sort of talk of the production freeze. So I think it's interesting. So thank you very much, everyone, and I'll leave it there. Here's another look at my disclaimer before I leave. We've just uploaded a new website, Handtech Markets. So go and check it out. It's handtechfx.com. And there is my usual research all in there in the research section as well. So check it out. And my Twitter handle is @handtechrich if you'd like to engage with me on Twitter. So thank you very much, everyone. And I will wish you good luck in all your trading, and I'll speak to you next time.